Andrei Kupchenko. It's not here on the slides. I don't usually do public talks because I am not that good public speaker. So bear with me with my when I will be reading my notes and so on. I will talk. Okay, first a few words about me. I started software development back in mid-80s. My first software was run on mainframes. I did a lot of open source development, participated in East European Linux distribution, packaging and management. For 20 years I ran different distributed organizations, commercial organizations. One of them is still alive. It's called 42 Coffee Cups. It's a software development company that holds no office and it's completely distributed. I'm in crypto, technically speaking, from 2011 when we first integrated Bitcoin payment gateway for one of our customers. But I started really deep in 2013 when the assets of our company were frozen in Bank of Cyprus. You can imagine, when you just wired all monthly salary of entire company to your bank account, and the next day you get a notice that your account is frozen. So your money goodbye, and your developers and your customers and your business. At that moment, I became a believer in not just decentralized, not just distributed, but censorship-resistant organizations, and that's why I'm giving this talk. How many of you know Giacomo Zucco? How many of you are familiar with his presentation called ICO Trilemma? Oh, I have to turn it on. Okay, so for those of you who isn't, you can find a transcript of my talk published on Medium, by Medium, and there is a link to his presentation. Basically, his idea is that when you try to combine three things, the investment that would be with intention of increasing value, the cryptocurrency that would be censorship resistant, and organization, you can't have all three, just all of them. I would like to oppose his opinion. That's why this talk. Basically, his idea is that when you are creating an organization, it should be centralized, and thus it should be easily censored with all consequences. So, let's go. Why your organization should be distributed? So far, most of management techniques and organizations haven't used the internet to its full extent. Management still relies deeply, believes deeply in presuppositions that information distribution is very slow and unreliable, and thus it should be managed in the fashion that was practiced like thousands of years. This centralization, this forces the information flow to be centralized and makes whole organizations that construct brittle, especially with in respect of regulatory action. The idea of regulation seems to be nice, quite attractive on first glance, but actually it isn't my deep belief. Because the only thing that regulators can do legally is to prohibit you to do something. In other words, they would limit your free will, and you cease to be a free being. Even worse, this slow degrades your ability to resist their actions, and until the point then when you become completely their property, and the whole system falls. If you are in doubt, just recall what ShapeShift had to do recently, or the very recent news I have read this morning on the plan, that the decentralized exchange IDEX that supposed to be peer-to-peer, reliable to regulatory action, they banned all residents of the state of New York from access. So, to build effective organization, it has to be able to resist such actions, and thus it should be decentralized. Yet, despite in the progress of in censorship-resistant technologies, they still have difficult time in enforcing complex behaviors that could not be specialized in at design time. Bitcoin is very good in censorship-resistant, but it could not bear very complex contracts. And if you would like to implement something more complex, it should be defined and coded, hard coded, basically at design time. Thus, to create effective and flexible organization, we have to solve a governance problem. I use this word in slightly different terms than Olkan. I do have a distinction between government and governance. Government, they are the people who are trying to regulate us. Governance is a process of us coming together to a joint decision, common decision about our project, our property, or something like this. Once again, governance problem. How organization stakeholders can coordinate their actions for their common benefit in censorship-resistant fashion? But let's start with the very beginning. What's an organization? Wikipedia defines an organization as an entity comprising of multiple people that has a collective goal and is linked to an external environment. In this talk, I will use organization to reference a set of people and their and relations between them that were created and grown up around a particular goal in the real world. So, once again, why distributed? People create organization for thousands of years. Actually, the whole history of civilization is a history of organizations. But due to limitations of communication technology, most organizations had to be decentralized. That had a person or cohorts of persons collecting information from bottom up and feeding instructions back to the bottom. This type of organization was more likely to survive in a harsh environment, and because it allowed different people to specialize in different kinds of trade. Those who were good in acting were acting. Those who were good at making decisions and analyzing complex behaviors were making decisions. And who was good in management just passed information from the bottom upside and translated the instructions from upside to upstairs. Every other type of organization for 1,000 years either died in competition or broke up in several centralized parts. So those hundreds and thousands of years resulted in evolving in at the peak in the concept of the corporation, just like it was described in the nature of firm, and the culmination, I guess, was the GM under Alfred Sloan management. And it was great. Centralized organizations are great until they are not. They are prone to problems. They are, by their own nature, they are resistant to change and adaptation. They are driven by politics and driven by internal goals and not the initial goals of initial stakeholders and people they were created to serve, or their customers. In other words, it might be comparatively easy to create a successful corporation. It is close to impossible to keep it successful beyond a certain size. And it becomes more and more obvious as the pace of change in our life grows. Those roadblocks are could be defined as to the origins of them, who could be traced to basically two problems: the principal agent problem, which occurs when one person's agent is allowed to make a decision on behalf of another person, the principal, which creates a situation of moral hazard and conflicts of interests, and hikes local knowledge problem, which is related to the fact that in real world the information is extremely dispersed, incomplete, and frequently contradictory. Who of you follows Naval? Have you seen this tweet? I'm trying to follow his suggestion that scaling a company by code and contracts instead of people mitigates the principal agent problems, and scaling the company by community-generated code and content mitigates the local knowledge problem. Let's use this as a hint in our research, but some more background. Exactly to those two problems, most of innovation in the United States since late 50s was not done in corporations, but in startups. Startup is a different thing, quite different organization. It's not a corporation that was created to execute a business model, but it's an organization which goal is to search for repeatable and scalable business model. In other words, startups are extremely unstable because of non-proven business model, and that makes them much more closely connected to the reality than any big corporation. But there is another issue. Any successful startup, but its own nature grows to an established corporation, which triggers two problems that I mentioned above. And unsuccessful startups die. Frequently they die because they develop a solution for the problems that nobody has. Meet lean startup. Lean startup is a methodology. Who is familiar with? Okay, so I won't dive deep. You know what's it? Basically, it's focused on validated learning, by introduction, introduction of accountability metrics, innovation accounting, and build measure learn cycle that allows your organization to focus on what's actually important instead of internal politics and vanity metrics. Yet it's still hard to create a culture of experimentation and continuous learning beyond the certain size of the team. This is because of an accepted style of doing business, running business. Organization leaders set goals, managers split them into specifications or requirements, documents, assigns budgets and deadlines, and pushes it to the implementation teams. For the information feedback loop, and even when it is created, a lot of energy is spent to keep it alive and objective. But when you change goals from the objectives that specify a solution that was required to a business problem statement that asks a question to be answered, things might change. Business problem statements focus on three things: the goals, the original goals of the product, service, company, system, the problem that was identified that requires some attention, and impact that it drives on organization, and the specific request for improvement state and as a change, not as a specification, but as a change in a customer behavior. Okay? So, if we would combine build, measure, learn loop with business problem statement, we can turn our organization into smaller teams that do not have a requirement to be co-located or co-managed or run in a traditional fashion. You can thread each of these build, measure, learn loop as an organization by itself. Or you can even run a market. Do I have a pointer here? You can specify a price for solving this problem and let different teams compete. Just like it was proven to be working by XPRIZE Foundation. Do you remember first XPRIZE? It was a project that offered a multi-million prize for a first privately built spacecraft that would start from the ground, reach open space, land by itself, and start again, reach the space within, as far as I remember, 48 hours. The same spacecraft.
Did Tesla achieve this?
Before SpaceX.
So okay. But don't they technically achieve it?
They did.
Right?
They did. The project is now commercialized. That I don't remember who does it. What this means for your project, that you can't split your whole entire problem space into sub-problems, define and change an objective result that you would like to obtain, set a price and let other people in your organization or other team compete for it. Of course, this was problematic until it's quite difficult to do in a regular fashion because you would be long dead while trying to account for each team efforts. But here we have a blockchain. And we can use it to implement the market mechanics. So that's why we I came to design a governance system in blockchains. This is a hot topic. And basically, any governance system could be summarized in three things. What a voter or stakeholder has to lose in a case of bad decision or conscious attack. What he pays or contributes in exchange for voting rights. And who has to the right to vote and why. I believe any governance system could be summarized and classified according to their answers for those three questions. Through and see what we had so far. The Fairlet example, the DAO. Who knows it? Who did invest there? who got the Ether back? Okay. So, the DAO was created as the first digital decentralized autonomous organization in early 2016 to mimic a venture fund on the Ethereum network. In a crowd sale, it collected about $150 million worth of Ether at May 2016 price, which was about 14% of entire Ether token supply, 12 and something million Ethers. For several short weeks, it seemed like the Holy Grail was found. And all future organizations would be built like the DAO. Yet in June 17 of 2016, the DAO smart contracts was the subject of an attack which siphoned about one sort of all collected Ethers in violation of the spirit of the project, but in strict adherence to its code. What would happen if there would be no bug, or at least it won't be discovered as fast? Would the DAO still a successful example? Unfortunately, nobody knows for sure, but even at that moment, there were quite few problems discovered with the with this project. The status of the DAO curator wasn't quite clear, the initial choice of curators wasn't clear, the process of whitelisting, re-sending the proposal wasn't clear, it has yet to be figured out, and there were various, again, theoretical properties of splitting off the DAO that weren't explored, and finally, this specific code was led to the bug that exploded. I believe that if the project would have time, everything would be figured out, but the time it had not. What the DAO did, it opened the way to it provided a tested roadmap for various ICOs initial coin offerings in 2016 and 2017. A lot of blockchain and not only blockchain projects rushed to use this crowdfunded method. to raise the funds, and it last year became crazy gold rush. But this is I see what, despite using a decentralized and quite censorship resistant nature of blockchain, where still I believe all of them are still at least every project that I know about is run as a centralized organization, which made them exactly target of centralized attack by a regulatory organization. Basically, when SEC issued the DAO report in July of 2017, they were all done. Despite raising, I have not updated figures, but I believe this year various ICOs raised north of $7 billion compared to 6 point something last year. Most of those funds were raised from centralized organizations like hedge funds and investment funds, venture firms, and other big players, not from a regular Joe. Kind of success. The Dash DAO. I will speak about the Dash because I'm very familiar with this. I do support Dash Electron, full disclosure. I own some Dash. That's why I know how it works in real life. How it's different from other governance systems. It doesn't try to govern the blockchain itself. The target of the governance is the Dash Treasury, which is built by providing 10% of mining reward every month to the selected projects. Who has a right to vote here? The masternode owners. Masternode is a special Dash node that should be collateralized by 1,000 Dash and has to provide special services for the Dash network. Right now it provides just two services, Instant Send, which instantly locks your UTXO before the block is produced, and the Private Send, which basically coin-joined. And basically the design idea of the Dash DAO was to recognize that in successful blockchain projects, there are several participants that should be rewarded. First of them are proof-of-work miners, who supply security to the network. Second would be in a Dash network, collateralized masternodes, which provide second-layer network services. And the third category is those who are impossible to qualify at the design time on the protocol level, but it requires human judgment to sort them out. So, as I have said already, the Dash Treasury, the Dash network directs up to 10% of the block reward to the Treasury. Interested parties may submit proposals to the Treasury in the for the funding to the Treasury in the decentralized fashion. Humans discuss this, those proposals, ask questions, and then masternode owners anonymously vote yes or no or abstain on those projects. And for successful projects that got more yes for some no. They are funded by grants from this treasury. And the whole Dash networks runs like this for more than 2 years. My project, the support of Dash Electron Wallet, is funded in the same way. I created a proposal, submitted to it to the network, paid a submission of the spam fee, and it was voted yes, and I get a monthly payment from the Dash network. It works perfectly for the Dash network. It wasn't hacked, and funded many successful projects around the world. But grants are grants. They are not loans, not investments, not any other commercial vehicle that would be used in a regular commercial transaction. The only thing that precludes the proposal owner from running away with the funds is the reputation. And you know that in a pseudonymous decentralized system is not a very reliable thing. Second issue is that the Dash Treasury is a single layer system, and since the Dash doesn't support any second level tokens, it couldn't be scaled in an obvious way. Because of this, last year Dash met with the problems of with funding various small projects that are that have a budget less or comparable to 5 Dash of submission fee. So, the idea. Why not combine the Dash Treasury system, which proven to be working, with smart contracts? Just like this. First of all, we would need some base asset. Since Dash Treasury is built on a proof-of-work inflation, we can't use any standard ERC-20 tokens with fixed supply. So instead, I'm using a simple POS token and modify it so some part of POS energy is withheld to the treasury. The treasury would be a separate smart contract that would store IPFS hashes of proposals, amount requested, proposal funding addresses, and collect the anti-spam submission fee. To reduce populism, we can require that only people who hold the necessary amount of base token to participate in the voting. And finally, a Bancor-style exchange smart contract would provide the liquidity of our token to Ethereum or any other cryptocurrency that is traded on regular exchanges. This way, we can mimic the governance system on, say, Ethereum blockchain, like I am doing right now. By re-implementing it on Ethereum blockchain, we get much more flexibility that it is present in Dash. We can it's because we can pay not just to an external owner account, but to a smart contract. First of all, obvious improvements. It's easy to replicate the DAO requirement of the project bond. The target smart contracts should hold necessary amount of our base token, and in case of failure to complete the project successfully, they would be either burned or diverted to treasury. Next, we can add some human judgment to determine whether the project was successful or not by asking our voters, masternode owners, to vote if they deem was the result successful, was the project successful or not. And for simpler projects, we can even encode those conditions in the project smart contract. Also, we can experiment with various forms of liquid democracy, introduce collateral lockup to increase voting power. We can do any kind of voting system experiment that we would like. Also, to mitigate the risk of dumping the base assets, it was this reason was claimed was raised in the DAO analysis. This is the reason why this system of funding doesn't quite work with BitShares, because BitShares owners vote to fund no projects, basically. So to reduce this risk, Treasury can send the project funds to another Bitcoin-style smart contracts that would pair our base POS token with the proposal token, which would introduce early liquidity to the proposed project participants and market feedback in the form of the project proposal token price. Finally, Treasury can find similar smart contract as itself, just create a second level DAO, which could be focused on any specific goal, say like marketing of your project, or focusing on a specific target market. The sub-DAO could be short-lived or long-lived. If it's long-lived, it could have its own governance structure and may create even more specific sub-projects as necessary. In this way, the holders of base token of base DAO are not required to deal with miniature details of those very detailed sub-projects and can focus on high-level goals of the system. And those people who like to work in the field can work with their low level to the ground, very close to reality DAOs, and get liquidity from them. Summing it up, using this proposal treasury structure, we can create a flexible on-chain governance system that could be as small or as big as necessary. It can be scaled, it could be used to implement the organization structure that I referred earlier when I talked about Lean Startup. Big problems could be attacked by issue problem, business problem statements, and have several proposals to compete for the success fee in solving them at the same time. Those proposals can be short-lived or long-lived as necessary, and they can get market feedback by issuing their own tokens. Since the proposal routing happens on-chain, the governance can be as public or as private as necessary while still being censorship resistant. While I still explore various game theoretical aspects of this proposal, I'm putting some, unfortunately, not enough time, but still some to implement this project as a Solidity project, which is in this repo. And the first working version of this governance system would be used to in my Temnulai project, which is focused on creating an artificial software developer. Thanks.